definitely the future is using saliva for more testing. And my kind of motto is that, like, you go to the doctor and you get a blood test. Why don't you go to the dentist and get a saliva test?
Welcome to Schein Chats. I'm Gerard Muchner with Henry Schein, and I am delighted to have with us today Dr. Victoria Sampson, all the way from London, here with us in Las Vegas at Thrive Live. Dr. Sampson, welcome. Dr. Sampson, with her sister, opened a practice in London about a year ago called a health society. And one of the things they do that's very different is a lot of work with oral microbiome. And so today we're going to learn a bit more about the oral microbiome. And I'd like to begin with this question. I am not a clinician. I'm a patient. How do you speak to your patients, and how do you recommend that other dentists speak to their patients about the oral microbiome?
I think that a lot of people know about the gut microbiome. Everyone has probably taken a probiotic or a prebiotic of some sort for their gut. And what a lot of people don't understand is that there's actually an oral microbiome as well. And it's the second most diverse microbiome after the gut. It's got 700 different bacteria in it, which make up 2 billion bacteria. So it's a big one. And we now know through all the research that an imbalanced microbiome, be it your oral microbiome, your gut, your skin, any of those microbiomes, once it's imbalanced, it causes disease. So that's how I usually actually speak about it to patients. I start with the gut because everyone knows that, and then I move it on to the oral microbiome. And when it's imbalanced, it can cause local diseases like decay and gum disease, but also it can contribute to systemic diseases and other general diseases like infertility, Alzheimer's, heart disease, and the list goes on.
We've discussed a particular instance where you had a patient, a 35-year-old woman, otherwise perfect health, someone who took care of her oral hygiene and had severe periodontal disease. Tell us about the work you did with that patient specific to the oral microbiome.
So our clinic that we opened, what we really wanted to do was try and personalize people's care. We didn't want the same copy-paste treatment plan for every single patient. And when it comes to the oral microbiome, there's so many different bacteria and so many contributing factors that can cause something like gum disease. So what we have weirdly started to attract are patients who have not been able to be treated in other clinics, and they become really unhappy. They've, you know, they're like, it's my fault. What have I done wrong? So yeah, this 35-year-old, she had had quite severe periodontal disease for 6 years. She had gone to numerous different clinics, different periodontal specialists, paid a lot of money for different treatments, and it just never was stabilized. So she came to us. She traveled over 2.5 hours each time to get her oral microbiome tested. We did blood tests on her. We looked at her diet, and we worked with a nutritionist as well as looking at her oral microbiome and what bacteria she had to actually personalize her treatment. So we knew exactly what antimicrobial mouthwash to use on her, antibiotics we had to use on her. We changed her diet. We did a lot of different treatments in the clinic on her, and we were actually able to stabilize her gum disease after one course of treatment, which was amazing to the point where she had actually left a review saying, I wish I'd come and seen you guys earlier. And she now understands what her gum disease is about. I think another thing is that a lot of patients think that when it comes to periodontal disease, or clinicians, we blame the patient and we say, oh, you're not brushing and it's your fault that you have periodontal disease. And we actually know now that it's not the patient's fault all the time. And there are so many other factors like your genetics, like your health, your general health, your deficiencies, all of these that can be contributing to that disease.
This really speaks to oral systemic health and the integration of dental and medical. You mentioned infertility and Alzheimer's before. Can you speak to each and what we're learning about the correlation of, for example, infertility with periodontal disease?
So Alzheimer's has been the one which has kind of blown up. It was on the New York Times. I think the New Scientist did something. A lot of different articles are coming out about it. And basically what they found is that patients with periodontal disease have a 70% increased chance of Alzheimer's. And these studies have been done over 15 to 20 years, 20-year long studies of over 30,000 patients. So they're quite large, very long studies. And they found that, yeah, periodontal disease increases your chance by 70% of Alzheimer's. But also what they found was that patients who suffer from Alzheimer's disease had specific oral bacteria and toxic enzymes in their cerebrospinal fluid, which can only be found in the mouth. So for those kind of naysayers who might be like, oh, it's just correlation, there's no actually causative mechanism there, that is one of the strongest evidence of that.
That there's actually a cause and effect.
There is a cause and effect because that bacteria is only found in the mouth. And when you think about it, the brain is like 9 inches or so from the mouth.
Not traveling far.
It's not traveling far. It makes a lot of sense. When it comes to infertility, there's a lot of strong connections with, for females, in terms of time of conception. So if they have periodontal disease, it takes them longer to conceive. Once they have conceived, they also have problems with delivery. So there's a higher chance of preeclampsia, of preterm birth, and low birth weight of those babies. And they did a really cool study in Malawi. And they basically, Malawi, one of the highest rates of preterm birth and low birth weight in the world. And so they split up a group of pregnant women into two. And half of that group had dental treatment and were given sugar-free chewing gum. And the other half were left to whatever they normally do. And what they found was that in the half that had had the sugar-free chewing gum and just, you know, having a hygiene, the rate of preterm birth and low birth weight reduced significantly. And this is where you start to see that actually something so simple and cheap, like chewing gum, like brushing your teeth and having a hygiene, can significantly impact not only the pregnant woman's health, but also the life and the future of a baby as well.
Seems motivational, doesn't it?
I think so, a little bit.
Let's talk about salivary diagnostics. You've done a lot of work on that, and you're also developing your own products. Tell us about the work that's being done there, because that's another avenue where people, I think, might better understand the connection of the mouth to the rest of the body.
I think it all started, this research has been going on for a very, very long time, but COVID really opened everyone's eyes to how useful saliva can be. I'm sure everyone who's listening has done at least one COVID test, and that is essentially using your saliva and putting it through a qPCR to see whether or not you have COVID. And we now know that actually saliva is an incredibly important diagnostic medium. We can use it to look at bacteria, inflammatory markers. We can look at specific enzymes which are correlating or, you know, connected to other general diseases like diabetes, oral cancer, heart disease. And so there's a lot of research going into using saliva to test and screen patients for other diseases. For the work that I've been doing, what I'm creating at the moment is an oral microbiome test, which has all of those combined into one package. So it looks at the bacteria, the inflammation, it looks at genetic mutations, and also the activity of that bacteria. So it's not just looking at, you know, what the microbiome is, but it's looking at how that patient is responding to that bacteria and therefore what treatment they need.
And is the testing specific to oral diseases, or can you imagine a day where you can use salivary diagnostics for other types of cancers?
So the future is that. And I think at the moment where at least my company is that we are collecting all of that data, and we're trying to kind of use machine learning and artificial intelligence to actually start to look at patterns and be able to trace maybe having these certain oral bacteria could increase the chance of this systemic disease 5 or 10 years down the line. So definitely the future is using saliva for more testing. And my kind of motto is that, like, you go to the doctor and you get a blood test, why don't you go to the dentist and get a saliva test?
Excellent. Dr. Sampson, thank you so much for your time. Thank you for visiting with us in Las Vegas. And thank you for watching Shine Chats.